Okay, so it is 8 a.m. I have some machine learning to do and some data analysis. So I thought I'd film one last day in the life of a data analyst on this channel. And we're starting a new project. It's pretty cool. But first, before I start my day, I better make some coffee. Okay, so I have my coffee and now I'm going to go into my office to start my day. So now that I have my coffee, I can give you a bit of a background on this project. It's the same client from all my day in the life videos, just because the client actually gave me permission to post about their project. But this client provides a service to customers. Now the service can be paid by the customer themselves, or if the customer has an insurance plan, the insurance scheme will pay for the service. The main issue that the client has is that sometimes the client will actually do and complete the service, but the customer just won't pay the bill. So my client wants to know, given the actual details of the service and the customer, like the type of service, the age of the customer, the type of insurance, etc., can we predict whether the service will be paid completely or not? So it is a pretty interesting use case, and now I'm in my office to get started. So the first thing I'm going to do is work on a project scope or project plan that I actually send to my client so they briefly know how many hours they're in for and what I'm exactly doing. So I'm going to do that now. So I'm done with my project scope and I'm going to show you what it entails. Now, the idea of a project scope is that often your client or your stakeholder will need timeframes. My client pays per hour I do work, so they need to know what they're in for. If you do work at a normal job, it's also good to give your stakeholder an idea of what you're doing and the timeframes so that they know what to expect. So now that we've done with that, I am going to start working on my data set. So I have a main data set here, and this is actually exported from the system that the client has access to. So this file gets sent to my email every week, and what I've been doing is I have been actually collecting this on a weekly basis since May last year. So we have quite a history, which is good, because for machine learning you do need a history. You need as much data as you can. Now what I'm going to do is quickly have a look at the data and check that everything is okay. Okay, so what I've done so far is that I've picked a few random files and had a look at them just to see that everything looks fine. Files aren't empty, there's no missing columns, and you don't have to do that for every file, but I just pick a few random ones so that I'm a bit more confident that the files I am actually importing into Python are reasonably decent. Once I have that data, I am ready to actually go ahead and import it into Python. So that's what I'm going to do. Okay, so let me try and show you what I've done. So as you can see, this is my Python script, and what I am doing essentially is I am setting my working directory as a folder, and Python is iterating through every file, extracting the Excel data, combining it by just merging it or concatenating it, and creating one big data frame. So now that we have our big data frame, I'm actually ready to clean my data. So now I'm done with some basic data cleaning and I'm going to move on to a next step, which is quite important in machine learning. It is feature engineering. So what exactly is feature engineering? So once I'm done with my basic cleaning, you have to do feature engineering. Feature engineering in machine learning is the process of creating new features, new variables that you think would help the model with what you're trying to predict. So for example, in my data set here, I have each customer's date of birth. To a machine learning model, it's just a date, and that is quite hard to analyze. Just with birth dates alone, it's hard to analyze or figure out what's happening. However, if we convert that to age, that becomes a lot more easier. And that's exactly what you need to do in feature engineering. Another example here is that I have something called service date. So from the service date, what I can calculate is a metric called days from service, which will be today's date minus the service date. So you can see how old the invoice is, because that might also assist the model in the prediction. So now I'm going to work a bit more on the feature engineering side. Okay, so now it is about 11 a.m. So I am going to take a break, but this is all that I've done. Again, this is a sample script that I am showing on the screen, but it's important to understand that often the data cleaning and transformation for machine learning models take the longest. Passing it into the model, getting your accuracy, all of that jazz, that actually is quite quick to do, but it's often the cleaning and pre-processing of your data takes the longest. So I'm actually done with most of the data cleaning. So now I'm going to have a quick break, have some coffee, and sit outside for a bit. Okay, so now that I'm done with my coffee, I am back in my office. I'm ready to pass the data through my machine learning model, which is often the coolest part. But before we do that, if you are interested in data analytics, well, here is a quick word from today's sponsor. I get asked this all the time. How do I get started with data analysis? And no matter what field you're in, data analysis is a vital skill to have, but it can be overwhelming to know where to start. Trust me, I know. So here are my top tips to help you get started. First up, do a short course. A structured, high-quality course can make all the difference. I highly recommend UCT's online short courses. It's done in collaboration with Get Smarter and edX. Their data analysis course is perfect. This course goes through the entire data analytics pipeline. You get to learn technical skills like Excel, databases, SQL, and data visualization. But the difference is you also learn about those important soft skills like interpreting outcomes and presentation to stakeholders. And to be honest, a short course like this from a reputable institution like UCT is a really good and fast way to kickstart your data analytics career. There is a clear roadmap, you're taught by industry professionals, and the skills you learn in this course can be applied to any job that you have. They also provide other interesting short courses such as digital marketing and project management. This one is definitely on my radar. I'd highly encourage you to check it out in case you find something that sparks your interest. And I do have a 20% discount code for you, so hopefully that motivates you a bit more. So use my code DATABUD2024 for 20% off any UCT short course on Get Smarter. Okay, so now we are ready to actually pass the data through our machine learning model. And the key here is actually selecting the right model. I'm using a gradient boosting model and it's a classifier, which means that the model will be predicting the specific invoice to fall into groups, such as invoice paid before 30 days, invoice paid between 30 to 60, etc. And before I pass the data into the model, there are a few steps that you have to do. So what I need to do is actually split the data into two sets, which is a training set and a testing set. So that's what I'm going to do. And then after that, I'll explain why we do that. Thank you. Okay. So let's quickly explain why you need to actually split the data set into training and testing. Yeah. So what happens here is that you need the model to be trained. The model needs to learn and understand your data. So you split the data into a training set, which has everything the model needs. It has all the features and it knows the target and knows the answer. So it looks at those different features, looks at when the customer pays, and actually makes a conclusion. It's almost like it's studying for an exam and it is looking at past exam papers with solutions. So now this line of code here actually trains the model. Once the model's trained, we're ready to test it. So we are testing it with unseen data. So in my test data, I will remove the target variable, i.e. the answer, and I'll keep it aside. And the model will try and look at the features and make the prediction. So that's what I am going to have a look at now. So the model has been tested, and now once testing is done, the next steps is often feature importance and checking the accuracy. With accuracy testing, what you do is compare the model's answers with your actual data set's target variable and see the accuracy from there. I'm getting an accuracy of 85%, which is great. It's a first draft, and there's also a few changes I need to make and check for overfitting and underfitting. And the next thing I like to do is generate a feature importance test, and that shows me specific features that are important to the model, and I'm going to do that. Okay, so this is how the feature importance chart actually looks. And it's quite cool because it tells you what features are important when it comes to the prediction. Now, what I'll do is I'll actually dig further into the data and the model predictions. Once that's done, I'll begin to actually write some notes, which detail overall trends, interesting things to note. So I'm actually going to stop here and give the client some feedback. It'll just be an email that I'll send to the client. It'll mention the accuracy, show them something like the feature importance graph, and maybe discuss some general trends or anything interesting that I found. Thank you so much for watching. This is probably going to be my last day in the life video for a while now. Like I said, I just have this one client who has given me permission to actually go through their project, their business problems, etc. And we're sort of nearing the end stage of it, and I don't really have much new content. So if there is a new project that comes up where I have permission to speak about it, I'll definitely post a video, because I myself think that it's often helpful if you see real life projects. It just gives you a better understanding than just going through a tutorial. But for now, I don't really have any more projects in my pipeline that I can show you. The projects that I work on are quite secure. But thank you so much for watching. Thank you so much for supporting the channel. I will see you sometime this week again with a different topic. Have a good week. Cheers.